We'll continue with our discussion on polarization in dielectrics. So we have seen that suppose we have a dielectric, okay, we have a dielectric material, and this is polarized by an applied electric field. So in the last session we have discussed, we have seen that this results in formation of dipoles. And this can be considered as equivalent to a combination of surface and volume bound charge charge distribution. So it will be like you will be having, so it is equivalent to a surface charge distribution and a volume charge distribution, rho pv. Okay. So this dielectric material which is polarized is equivalent to a bound surface charge distribution and a bound volume charge distribution in free space. So we can now replace the dielectric material by these two charge distributions and consider the effect of dielectrics. Now let us have, apart from this dielectric, so the dielectric is assumed to have a free charge distribution also, okay, and this free charge distribution is, let's say, it's given by rho v. And so now we can apply the point form of Gauss law, and we can see that at any point, now so at any point the total charge density is given by rho v plus rho pv. So here this is due to the free charges, whereas this is due to the bound charges. Okay. So we can apply the point form of Gauss law in free space. So in free space we can see that divergence of epsilon naught E is equal to the total charge density at this point, and here the total charge density is here the sum of the free charge distribution, that is free charge density, and also the polarization charge density. So therefore it is given by rho v plus rho pv. So therefore divergence of epsilon t is equal to rho v, and because we have seen that rho pv is given by minus divergence of p. So if we substitute here minus divergence of p, and then rearranging, we will be getting is equal to rho v, or we can say that divergence of d is equal to rho v, and here d is given by, now in a dielectric material d is given by epsilon naught e plus the polarization. So we can see that the effect of polarization is to increase the flux density. Okay. So in case of if you apply an electric field in free space, this will be the d is equal to only epsilon naught e. Okay. Whereas when we have a dielectric material, the flux density is given by is increased by this amount P. Okay, so this is the effect of the dielectric material. So the dielectric material increases P. Okay, for some dielectrics, okay, so P is that is polarization varies linearly with respect to E. So for such cases we can take P as equal to epsilon naught. This quantity is known as electric susceptibility and E. Okay, so if you substitute this P here in D, so D is given by epsilon naught E plus epsilon into electric susceptibility to E, or we can write it as epsilon naught plus this quantity. So here this is known as electric susceptibility of the material. It's an indication of how easily the dipoles are formed when an electric field is applied. So this can also be written as D is equal to epsilon naught epsilon r E, where epsilon r is the relative permittivity of the material, and it is given by 1 plus electric susceptibility of the material. So we can note, we can observe that this epsilon r is dimensionless. Whereas epsilon is given by epsilon naught epsilon r. So this has unit of farad per meter. So the role of dielectric here is to increase the flux density. So when an electric field is applied, it increases the flux density by forming bound and bound volume and bound surface charge distributions, and also through this dielectric, the since the charges are not moving, okay, there is no conduction current. But so this dielectrics are used as many of the dielectrics are used as insulators. For example, if you have a transmission line, okay, so you have two conductors, okay, so between them air is that is overhead transmission line, air is the insulator, okay, because air here prevents the air is a dielectric and it prevents the flow of current from these two conductors which are at different potentials, okay. But it's possible that when the electric field is increased, okay, so if this E, the electric field between the conductors is very high, or surrounding the conductor, okay, so surrounding the conductor, the in the region surrounding this conductor, so it's possible that E may be greater than a value what is known as a dielectric strength of air. Okay, so any material will have, any dielectric material will have a property known as dielectric strength. So this dielectric strength is the maximum electric field. Okay, so it is the maximum electric field that a dielectric can tolerate. So that a dielectric can withstand or tolerate without electrical breakdown. So it is possible that if the potential difference between two conductors is very high, So electric field also will be high. So it's possible that there may be a breakdown between the two conductors. The air may break down, or more commonly in the region surrounding the conductors. So the electric field may be very high. Okay, so suppose this is the conductor. So here in the region surrounding the conductors, the electric field here may be greater than the breakdown strength of the air. So in this region, the air will break down, and it is known as this phenomenon is also known as corona. Okay, so here it is not complete breakdown of the air between the conductors 1 and 2, it's only in the region surrounding this conductor. Okay, so here in this case the dielectric material will become conducting. Okay, when the dielectric breakdown occurs, so the dielectric strength is defined as it's a maximum electric field. Okay, so for example, for air at normal atmospheric temperature and pressure, the dielectric strength is 30 kV per centimeter, so approximately. So it means that the air can withstand a field of 30 kV per centimeter, but beyond which it will break down. But please remember that this breakdown strength is also dependent on many other parameters like temperature, pressure and humidity. So we need to know about this property of the dielectrics. So dielectrics are widely used as insulators, but when the field exceeds the dielectric strength, this dielectrics will break down and they start conducting. Now let us also discuss about briefly about linear isotropic and homogeneous dielectrics. So a dielectric is said to be linear if D is proportional to E. Okay. Otherwise, it's said to be nonlinear. Okay. A material is said to be homogeneous if let's say we have a dielectric material. So if the epsilon at all the points, that is permittivity of the material at all the points, is same, then it's the material is said to be homogeneous. Okay, so if the permittivity is varying from one point to another point, okay, that is if permittivity is a function of let's say xyz, then it is said to be non-homogeneous. So isotropic. So isotropic means the permittivity of the material is same in all the directions. So whether whether it's in this direction, that is y direction or x direction or z direction, if the permittivity is same, then the material is said to be isotropic. So we can conclude that the material is linear, okay, if D is equal to epsilon E, and this epsilon, that is permittivity, does not change with the field, then the material is said to be linear. And a material is said to be homogeneous if epsilon, that is permittivity, does not change from point to point and the material is said to be isotropic if epsilon does not change with direction. So let us look at some of the dielectric materials, and note down their permittivities and the dielectric strength. Let's say, for example, air. Okay, air at 1 atmosphere. Okay, it has a dielectric constant that is epsilon r. Okay, that is relative permittivity of 1. Okay, close to 1, and its dielectric strength. So it is about 3 × 10⁶. That is volts per meter. So we can see that it is also equal to 30 kV per centimeter. And also we can look at the paper. So paper has a has relative permittivity of 7, and its breakdown strength is 12 × 10⁶ volts per meter. We can look at bakelite. So bakelite has a relative permittivity of 5, and its dielectric strength is 20 megavolts per meter. Okay, so these are some of the examples, but please note that this epsilon, that is permittivity, is also a function of frequency. Okay, so the values that are given here are corresponding to low frequency. So here maybe about less than 1000 hertz, but this permittivity is also a function of frequency. So if the permittivity changes with increase in frequency, so this is about, this is the values that are given here are for low frequency conditions. So with this we will end this session. Thank you.